Hi, I'm Paul Zawaska, and welcome to another edition of Beacon Bench. Today we're going to be covering refurbishing a Streamliner chalker. The Streamliners have been around now for about 8 or 9 years, and chances are you might have a chalker of ours that's been around for 5 or 6 years, and you're finding that's not performing as well as it used to when you got it out of the box brand new. Fortunately, with the Streamliner chalkers, you can get a refurbishing kit from us, and you can actually go in, change some integral parts in this unit, and have it dropping chalk as good as new, just like it was when you got it the first time. And I don't know of any other chalking unit out there in the market that can do that. So that's the beautiful thing about the Streamliner. All right, so what you're gonna get is a package from Beacon. This is your refurbishing kit that you'll order. And this has all the important parts that we'll need that we'll replace inside here, starting out with the agitator brush that we use on the inside of the unit. This brush goes on the axle, and of course it rotates around and carries the chalk down to the drop slots of the chalker. Now, this doesn't wear that much. The amount that it wears out is so finite, but it does drastically affect the flow of the chalk, and that's why we do replace this in the unit. And you'll notice when we replace it, there's a certain wispy sound that we hear. That's when we know that this unit is operating properly, when you get that sound from the brush. The other things we'll put in will be new bearings for the axle. Chalk tends to get into these bearings over the course of time, and as that happens, it'll tend to bind up a little bit. The wheels might not turn as freely, so we change these bearings out. They're already pre-greased on the inside, so all you have to do now is stick the axle in. Also, we'll put the mask on the bottom. This controls the on and off flow of the chalk, as well as the size of the line. Here's the 4-inch and the 2-inch drop slot. This will wear in time as well, and as the unit ages, sometimes when you shut it off, chalk will tend to leak out through these openings sometimes. So by replacing the mask, that tends to fix that. Also, these springs here tend to get stretched out over time, so some new strings doesn't hurt either. New springs, I should say, doesn't hurt either. And then finally, we've got some cotter pins here that we're going to need to attach the brush to the main axle and to reattach the wheels when we put them back onto the main axle, because it's just too hard to use the original ones. The tools you're going to need, what I've got here today is a long nose needle nose plier and also a rubber mallet. Sometimes for taking these cotter pins out, it might help to have a cotter pin puller, which looks like a long awl with a hook on it to reach in there and pull those things out, or any other tool like that you can think of that you might have in your toolbox to use to pull these out sometimes, because it can get kind of tough to reach in to where these wheels are to get at those cotter pins at times. So if you've got those tools, great. We also have some instructions inside that packet as well, which I'm going to use today and follow to put this together. So let's get started. All right, so we're ready to get started here, but the first thing we have to do is make sure that all of the chalk is out of the hopper. So we'll take this unit, tip it over, and dump the existing chalk out into a bucket or a box or whatever it is that you have available. And when you do that, make sure that you spin the wheels to turn the brush on the inside of the unit, because that will also be loaded up with chalk. That chalk will then dump out, shake it really good, do everything you can to get as much of the chalk out, or it's going to be a pretty messy operation, especially if you're wearing black like I am today. All right, so according to the instructions then, the next thing we're going to do is we're going to remove the large springs on the front portion of the hopper. So there's a couple of cotter pins that come down off of this, the top of the hopper here. We're just going to take those, and actually I'm going to grab the needle nose pliers, and we're just going to pull those springs out. And of course there's always one oddball that wants to stick. Okay, that's going to free up these two pins. I'm just going to pull those out temporarily so that they don't fall out and roll around somewhere. And then we'll take that mask off on the back side. We'll unhook it from the control rod. We can drop it down low enough that it will unhook. The control rod can just hang there on the back mount. All right. So we'll take that and throw that away. All right. The next thing we're going to do is remove the cotter pins from both sides of the wheels. I'm going to have to turn the unit upside down for that to get at it. So if I take that, stabilize that on the bench, we're just going to bend these cotter pins back. So we'll pull this cotter pin out now that I've brought that back together again.
pop this out. Sometimes a screwdriver or a cotter key puller tool will work really well here. Hey, look at that. Okay, that's one of them. And now we'll get the other. Now that we've got that straightened out, we'll pull this one out as well. All right, so now we have both wheels off. We removed the old cotter keys, which we do have replacements in the kit. Now it says here we're going to move both rear wheels. We've done that. And we're going to use a rubber mallet to tap the axle in both directions to remove the inner and outer wheel bearing. We'll take this rubber mallet now. We're going to hit the axle on the opposite side, and that'll pop this bearing out. Just like that. And normally we can twist those out. And then the same thing on the other side. That pops out pretty easy. All right. Well, if that's the inner bearing, that'll come out when we take the brush out. Now we'll turn this unit back over, and on the inside on the brush, we have another cotter pin on the inside here. If you take a look on the inside, there's a cotter pin right in here that we've got to take out to pull that brush out. All right, so I've got it nice and straight here. We'll spin that around, get a good grab on it, and yank her out. Now we can slide the axle out and take the brush out of the unit. Now we're ready to put the new parts in. So I'm going to take my new bearings out of the bag here. They've already been pre-greased. All right, and we're just going to pop these right in. Take your rubber mallet. Give them a little tap. Take the other side. Pop that in. Give it a little tap. All right, bearings are in. Now we'll slide the axle through with the brush on the inside. Cover on the front. Stick the brush in and feed the axle through. Actually, now on this, I actually pushed these bearings in just a hair too tight where I couldn't get the brush in. So now, there we go. It's a nice fit now. So we'll feed those through. Thread the, come on. Yeah. There it goes. All right, so now we've got the axle all the way through both sides. I'm just going to make sure that these bearings are nice and tight in there. Give them a little tap on each side. Looks good. All right, we'll slide one wheel on. Line up the hole. Put our cotter pin down, take our needle nose plier, and that cotter key back into position. Get our second one, line that one up. Get our other new cotter key, put it into position. All right. Give it a couple bends in each direction, and that's ready to go. So now what we'll do is we'll take this pin, we'll rotate the brush on the inside and find the hole in the axle where it meets the hole with the brush. So we're going to turn this brush in here and find the point where the pin is going to go through the entire unit here, through the brush and then also through the axle. So we find that point, line it up as best we can, and send the clevis pin through like that. I'm going to give this a little spin here, and this is where it gets tricky because one side of your hand is going to have to hold that pin so it doesn't fall out while you get to the other side and start to bend this back. We'll get our needles in there, bend that part way one direction, bend it back in the other, and once I get a little bit of a bend on it, now I can come back in here and do a better bend on it, bending it the rest of the way down so it's not going to pop out on us. Okay, now once that's in place, we can put the mask back in place. I'm going to slip the control rod back into its slot. Slide that back down. We'll get the new mask. Now we're going to put this, there's a rough side on this and there's a shiny side on it. We're going to put the shiny side up because it'll slide a little bit easier on the plastic. Once we get it on there, I'm just going to take this, wipe some of this excess crud off the bottom that it rides against. And then the first thing we'll do is we'll hook up the mask. So now we're going to replace this mask on the back side here. We need to hook it to the control rod. We want to make sure that the handle over on this side here is sticking out with the notches for the control. All right, so we'll send this up, glossy side up against the popper. All right, we slide this up, take it up here, and we turn that in so that hook grabs it. We can bring that back down, and now we can go ahead and attach these springs on the front side. All right, then we're going to bring that back around and rehook those pins back into those cotter bolts here. Slide those back through. And take our springs and rehook them. And I'm going to close those. We open the hooks up a little ways to make it easier. Now we'll close that hook back up so it doesn't come undone too easily. Hook this one up. Close that over. All right. Set the unit back up. Actually, first I'll show you to make sure that this mask is working properly. I'll just double check it. It should be off in that position, which means the open slots on the bottom are covered up as they are. If I bring this up to the 2-inch level, she's fully open, and fully open in the 4-inch, and everything's operating properly. You'll notice a feel on these springs, obviously brand new springs, it's gonna be a little bit tighter. So we'll take a little bit more of a tug when you first start using it again. But with all that done, we put the cover back on. This unit is now ready to go. And you will notice, you hear that sound, that's the sound of a Streamliner, all right? When you lose that sound, that's probably a good sign that it's time for this unit to need a rebuild. So if you start to lose that wispy sound that you hear as this thing turns in there, chances are it's worn down just enough that it probably needs to be rebuilt. And now that you've seen the rebuild kit at work, we can put this unit back into operation out on the fields, and you're going to notice a completely different chalker. Thanks for coming today. That's it for this edition of Beacon Bench. Hope to see you again here real soon.